John, right here from MuscularDevelopment.com at the 50th anniversary of the Joe Weider Mr. Olympia with David Bay and Peter McGough. We just concluded round one of the men's prejudging not moments ago. And Peter, this one had to be something to talk about. A lot of testosterone on that stage. It looked like Phil and Kai still carried over from the press conference. A little bit of bad blood between the two.
Absolutely. I've never seen such hostility on stage in a pro contest. Seen it in amateurs. It all started when Kai playfully flicked his pigtail back, hit Phil. They both sort of laughed at that. And then when they started banging elbows at one point, Kai went right into Phil's face. Phil stood up to him. It really did look like it wasn't staged at all. It really looked like the fight was going to break out.
Yeah. For a second, I thought we were going to see some fisticuffs. And clearly the judges wanted to separate that madness. But is this because the stakes are so high and the race is really close? Or is this just a personal battle with Kai and Phil?
You know, I've talked to a couple of guys, other pro bodybuilders and stuff that know these guys, and there was a lot of questions as to whether the things at the press conference were staged for drama purposes, and I have been assured by numerous guys that it is not. These guys genuinely don't like each other, so I think what played out tonight on the stage was just true bad blood, and like Peter said, Kai got in Phil's face. I don't know if he thought Phil was going to back down. Phil obviously didn't. Steve Weinberger, not happy one bit with the antics that was going on stage, separated the two guys. You know, you can assume that I shouldn't say that they're one and two, but to see a presumably one and two place guys separated speaks volumes about they thought something might go down further than that. I don't know.
It's clearly a battle for one and two, and right now it does still seem to be a battle between Kai and Phil. Is this good versus evil? I mean, let's talk about the champ. Did he deliver the goods? Because to me, it looked a little bit heavy in the midsection, heavier than the years before. But as soon as he started hitting those poses, he came alive, and he still looked like the champ to me.
Yeah, I think he wasn't like he was in 2011. He wasn't as full, and that sort of cut down on the detail. The fuller you are, the more the detail cuts into you. Pose for pose, I had them pretty close. You know, I think Kai won the two front poses. But at the end, you know, It always comes down to the most muscular shot. That's a take-home one for Phil, and it's maybe Kai's weakest pose. That's the conundrum there. I think overall, Phil's just edged it tonight, but it's still 50% of the points tomorrow. I think he has to fill out. Phil has to fill out.
No pun intended. Yeah, no pun intended. Are you in agreement with him right now? Does it still seem like it's Phil's contest to lose, or did Kai close the gap a little bit?
I think it's pretty neck and neck. I think maybe Phil has a slight edge. I don't think Phil is quite as razor sharp and as full as he was last year. And to me, this is the best that we've seen Kai look in a while. So, you know, Kai, you know, he talked a lot at the press conference and he definitely brought it. Like Peter said, half of the judging is done tomorrow night. Phil's, if he wants to shut that door like he did last year, he's going to really have to fill out and dry up a little bit before tomorrow night, because right now it is very close.
Yeah, not only is it close, but where does that leave third and fourth, presumably, if we're talking about that? I mean, Dennis Wolf, did he do enough to hold off a charging Sean Roden? Because it sounds like that's where the battle for third and fourth is right now.
Yeah, I think Wolf came to his usual dilemma. He was full when he came out, and then he faded a little bit. Mm-hmm. The revelation of the show was Roden. We'd heard these stories about 15 pounds. I'm not sure he put 15 pounds on, but he's put some quality mass on and still kept his shape. And this seemed to be a new Roden. He was almost a showman. We've never seen that before, playing to the audience. You know, I mean, he looked very confident and calm, and he's the sleeper of this show.
No doubt, he is the sleeper, and he came alive. The more he posed, the harder he got. Very reminiscent of a Flex Wheeler back in the day. Tiny little waist, nice small joints and muscle bellies. But was that enough to take Dennis and regulate him out of the top three?
I think that you'll probably see Sean ahead of Dennis. Again, half of it is tomorrow. If Dennis fills out a little bit, Dennis was really lean. To me, he looked like he streamlined a little bit, got a little bit crisp, probably lost a little bit of that fullness we usually see with him. But Sean was at his all-time best. You know, when Sean jumped on the scene a few years ago, everybody was real big on the guy, said, if he can get bigger, he can be a real threat. Well, he has gotten bigger. Again, I don't know that he's put on 15 pounds, but he is noticeably bigger than in past, and he's every bit as sharp, if not a little bit sharper. So right now, I think it's real close between Sean and Dennis for third place. If I had to give the edge tonight, I would give it to Sean.
Well, we still have tomorrow, which is 50% of the judging, and that still leaves us with the ever-ready battery in the form of a Dexter Jackson. I mean, this guy's a perennial top five guy. Who would be picking up sixth place?
Well, I think Rami's in there, but, you know, Rami, again, you know, we're waiting for this big breakthrough, and it didn't happen tonight. Yeah. I mean, from the back, there was all sorts of stuff not going on, if you can say that, you know. And, you know, although he's got huge body parts, that's not enough in this league. You know, you need the detail there. As for Dexter, you know, this has happened before, where pitchers a few weeks before, a guy's been awesome, and he's been awesome on the day, but not as awesome, and so you feel a bit disappointed. He wasn't as good as I expected. One guy that I really thought should have been in the second call-out, and certainly not in the last one, was William Bonnock. Mm-hmm. I don't know what he's not seen in. He was sharp, he's got the muscle, he's got the shape. I was really, really surprised to see him in that last call-out.
Yeah, what about you, David? Did you see any other surprises? Because right now, it sounds like Peter's spot on. I mean, Rami did not bring the detail. And he did not deliver in the time that he should have.
Yeah, a couple of surprises to me. One, I thought Steve Kuklo looked fantastic. He dropped down pretty low. I was a little bit surprised in a negative way with Rolly. He came out, needed to control his stomach a little bit more. We're used to seeing Rolly kind of with this soft look when he walks out, when he hits his poses, he really pops. It was the same way tonight, but he just wasn't, you know, I'm a big Rolly fan, so I was hoping that he was going to really bring it tonight. Was off a little. Really surprised as well with William Bonak. I mean, to me, you know, we saw him place ahead of Branch Warren and Evan Santopani in Australia earlier this year. You know, would have liked to have seen him a little bit higher in Brazil, and to see him drop as low as he did tonight against, you know, some guys that he's beaten in the past, I'm not sure that that I necessarily agree with it, but, you know, maybe he wasn't quite as sharp as he was in Australia, and that's why he's getting docked.
Excellent commentary. Let's make way, make some room for Big Dan Solomon from Pro Bodybuilding Worldwide. Great job, Peter. Go ahead.
There's a drunk about to come on the set. Good night.
Let's bring on the voice of professional bodybuilding over here, Dan Solomon. Make some way over here. Big Dan, you have a totally different perspective because, of course, you've been around the block. You see things a little bit differently. But let's get your take on this thing.
Well, forget about my take. I just immersed myself in a sea of fans who are all wondering if Phil has opened the door for somebody to hop in and take that title. That's the sentiment around the arena right now. I'll put that right out there. We came to the show tonight really looking at three guys. We wanted to see what Kai was going to bring, what Dennis was going to bring, and what Phil was going to bring. And that's no disrespect to Sean Rhode, and Sean looked terrific. Those are the three guys that we were looking at coming in. And we were hoping that they would all three arrive at their best. And I hate to say it, 0-3. They weren't all at their best. Neither of them were. Phil opened the door. The question is, did he open it wide enough? And I don't know.
Well, we've seen things happen in 24 hours. I mean, Kai was a different bodybuilder last year on Friday night than he was on Saturday night. So right now, I think the playing field's kind of level. They all have got to improve by tomorrow night to really, you know, make a statement.
I was among many people who thought Phil was just going to show up here and pick up his fourth Sandow trophy. Now, when the dust settles, it might play out that way. He might win this title. Phil was prepared. Dennis was prepared. So was Kai. But when you really break it down, there's an opening right now. And when we meander about the expo tomorrow and we're talking to fans and the boards light up, there's going to be a lot of people, mark my words, that are questioning whether or not Phil did enough to retain the title.
No doubt. We're going to listen to you on Monday on Pro Bodybuilding Radio Worldwide. We're going to get to the other results for tonight. Any other surprises in the men's division for you that you saw?
It shouldn't be a surprise to me, but at 44 years old, Dexter Jackson continues to blow my mind.
Another top five finish for sure.
Incredible. He's just he just never disappoints. He walks out there each and every year, and for some reason, Vegas brings out the very best in Dexter. He's tremendous, and he deserves all of our respect for what he's able to do.
Right on. We'll be listening to you on Monday. Thank you for the commentary,
yes,
Big Dan.
Well done, guys.
All right, thank
all
you.
Right.
Big Dave, we had some other business going on the other end. We had some rewards. We had some women's finals. Let's talk about the first one in the bikini, because this is the first time we've ever seen a two-time bikini Olympia champion, 2-peat.
Yeah, since the bikini division, I didn't even know this until I talked to Ashley last night at the athletes meet and greet. There's never been a repeat bikini champion. It was real close after prejudging this morning with Janet and Ashley. Now, there was a really tough lineup in your top six, yep, but they kept Janet and Ashley in the middle, so we had a pretty fair idea that those were going to be your top two. As I've said in the past with Ashley Kaltwasser, when she turns around, she's got that bubble butt. She's just got a small frame, yep, and a bubble butt, and, you know, just as bodybuilding shows are won from the back, same goes for bikini. So I think that's where Ashley edged out Janet. Yeah. But for Janet to be at her first Olympia and take second, absolutely fantastic.
And we also saw history be made by Iris Kyle, 10-time Ms. Olympia champion, retires promptly right after she wins her 10th Sandow trophy.
Yeah, Iris, to me, she was a little bit off this morning. You know, I had commented that she might have left the door open a little bit. I don't think Alina, you know, jumped in as much as we would have liked to have seen. But Iris came out tonight, in my opinion, noticeably better than she was this morning. And we saw the Iris Kyle that we're used to. 10 Olympia wins, you know, as Bob said, I don't know that we're ever going to see that from any other competitor. And it's definitely a good way for her to go out. 10 wins, 50th anniversary Olympia. So my hat's off to Iris.
Yep. And on the fitness side, we saw a new champion be crowned in Oksana Grishina in the absence of 8-time Miss Fitness Olympia, Adela Garcia.
Yeah, you know, the routines tonight were all really good. We had a lot of fun. You know, this is the Olympia. It's what we expected. For as good as everybody else's routines were, Oksana's was just on a totally different level. You know, she's Russian. She's got that dancing background. It showed so much. There was excitement. Her routine was just spot on, absolutely polished. And I think she just, you know, she just slammed the door tonight with the routine. But if you saw prejudging this morning, you know that she wasn't in that top two mix. You know, they brought the top three out, Tanji, Bethany, and Oksana. And then later on, they just brought Tanji and Bethany back out. So Oksana lost a little bit of ground this morning in the physique division, came out and really nailed it for the routine.
Yep, and tomorrow we've got, what else do we have tomorrow? We have the men's finals, we have the men's physique and the women's physique finals.
Women's physique and the figure finals are going to be tomorrow.
Yep. And the 212. So a lot still ahead of us. But right now, the men's prejudging is over. Let the boards light up. Let the people talk about it. And tomorrow's going to be a brand new day, and we'll find out who comes out victorious. For David Bay, Peter McGough, Dan Solomon.